So why is that? I mean, how can this be related to mixed law structures? But the point is that there is indeed a step in between, which is the fact that we use this dimensional regularization of integrals, and okay, they wrote it in a different form. There's some manipulations that go between the dimensional regularization form that I showed before and this one. Essentially, one way to look at this is that you're looking at integrals like that, where again, this is the function that defines the graph hypersurface, and this is some differential form on the defined over projective space. And the point is that this is a Mellin transform of something, which is this Gelfand-Liret function, which satisfies a regular singular equation. So this is the regular singular equation that comes related to the mixed dot structures and the motifs and so on. But when you pass to thinking of that, of the Feynman integral, especially using the dimensional regularization method, which is what we did in the work with Kahn, you are in between taking a Mellin transform. So you don't expect this anymore to be a solution of a regular singular differential equation. In fact, we can show that starting from solutions of the Picard-Fuchs equation, which is the regular singular equation associated to the singularity of the hypersurface, one can construct an irregular singular differential equation of the kind that Kahn and I consider in our work. So this does not give a complete identity between the two set of data, but I mean it shows that at least you go from the right kind of equation on one side to the right kind of equations on the other side. So I don't, I think I'm kind of running out of time, but I want to finish by a more speculative or anyway less precise discussion about dimensional regularization. So as I said at the beginning, this is a recipe that physicists use to replace a divergent integral by a Lorentz series. And they call it integration in dimension, in complexified dimension, but there's no attempt in theory to make any sense of geometry in with a dimension which is a complex number, only to give a certain prescription for how to generalize Gaussian integrals. From that, all the computations follow, so maybe, again, if you are a physicist, that's enough. You don't want to know the computations work, but there's no, there's no need for that, for having a geometry in complexified dimension. But what I want to say is that there are two possible approaches. If one would like, think as a mathematician that making sense of geometry, of giving a geometric content to dimensional regularization would actually be beneficial to theory. So how can one try to do that? So at present, there seem to be two possible approaches. One uses non-commutative geometry, and we sketched towards the end of our book that Klaus mentioned in his introduction. And there is also one that seemed to be more based on motives. And again, the first one is more closely related to this top-down approach that I mentioned, and the second one is more related to the bottom-up approach. So in both cases, the idea is that when you do dimensional regularization, what you're really doing is to take a product of something which is an ordinary geometry by something else. And this something else is, well, in one case, a non-commutative space. I don't have much time to say what that means. But in the other case, it's a certain projective limit of motifs. So very, very briefly, the point of the first approach is that there is a notion, in non-commutative geometry has a notion of dimension for spaces, which is a complex number, which gives you a dimension, which is a set of complex numbers. So it's called the dimension spectrum. So in particular, you may look for a way, and I mean, it's something, you can do it through something which is called spectral triples, which is a way to construct non-commutative spaces. Construct one of such objects that has, whose dimension is a single point, which is a complex number. And then, by taking a product of space-time on which your original theory lives, by a gadget like this, a non-commutative space whose dimension is just a single complex number, z, you move away from the integer dimension of space-time, d, to a d plus z dimension. And then the formula for the Gaussian integration that is generalized to do all the computation of dim reg becomes a formula for the trace of a heat kernel of a certain Dirac operator on this non-commutative space. So this is one geometric interpretation of what dimensional regularization means. And the ways that you can do products for these spaces in a nice way. And actually, this has, one can give a concrete model for how to construct such a space. It's too long to describe it, but it comes from a certain quotient of the Adels by the action of Q star, the Adels of Q by the action of Q star. So there is a concrete model of how to obtain a space like this. Well, the other one, and I finish with this one, with this slide, the other approach is to have a certain, construct a certain limit of, a certain projective limit of motives. So you have a very simple kind, so finally I show one of these models in the space, I'm talking about them. But so you have a, these are the motive of a point and the informal inverse of the motive of a line. And there are non-trivial extensions of these motives. That's the only part which is really difficult in the theory of motives, is the extensions of, in the theory. And in particular, this extension has a period which is given by a logarithm. It's called the Kummer. And you can make this into a sheaf over the multiplicative group, where over each point you have log of the Q, the corresponding Q in the base. And you can take inverse limits, where now the period matrix becomes more complicated. And again, you can think of the graph hypersurface itself as a motivic sheaf over the multiplicative group, because you have a natural map from these two GM given by the function itself. And you can look at the dimensional regularization as taking a product in a suitable category of motivic sheaves, which is this Arapura category of motivic sheaves, taking a product with this with this projective limit of motives. And then the dimensionally regularized integral would become a period on this product, rather on this, which is a fiber product, a period on this fiber product. Okay, these are both still, both descriptions are a little bit vague at this point, and they're just an idea of how to try to make more geometric the whole picture about dimensional regularization and so on. But so I hope, many of these things are still, of course, in the process of being developed. This is a rather active field at the moment, so I don't have a final answer on the question of the relation between quantum field theory and motives, but I hope I more or less managed to give at least a picture of where the interesting problems lie and what people have been trying to do with that. So yeah, sorry for maybe a little over time. But.
Thank you very much for this extremely impressive and overwhelming talk. It's ironic that Alain Kohn, in fact, once said that he was repelled by the scene around Grothendieck and picked a thesis subject that was as remote as possible from algebraic geometry, namely operator algebras. Now you see what has come out of this. So those who are interested in this topic should certainly read the book by Kohn and Marcolli, but might also consider coming to the mini symposium on non-commutative geometry and applications in the afternoon. I propose to defer questions to the break and to that mini symposium, where I hope you'll be available to answer them. And let's thank Professor Marcolli once more.